My name is Philip Engström and I am a visual effects supervisor at Important Looking Pirates. We were tasked with quite a few things actually. The biggest things was of course some of the stormy ocean stuff that you can see in episode one, as well as some of the cliff replacement as Blackthorn wants to save Rodriguez from down below the cliff as he's kind of barely conscious in the crashing waves below. We also of course had a large scale army that we should create, and the big landslide that you can see in episode 5. And then take that and sprinkle in some large scale environments as well. We were tasked with creating Toranaga's camp that of course gets swallowed up with the landslide in episode 5 and sort of the remnants for some of the later episodes. I think one of the more difficult shots to achieve was, well actually it was more of a sequence. Of course when you see the galley coming over the wave and crashing down onto the surface in one of the stormy ocean sequences, that was a tricky one because it's a large scale water simulation. You had to have a big ship crashing through a wave and then slamming down. There's a lot of secondary elements that played a big role in that. But for the cliff sequence, that was a bit more challenging, I think, because we had, the camera was quite unforgiving. It was often very static cameras just looking at the effect. We didn't really have any place to hide. So the effect needed to hold up to the amount of scrutiny that you would get with a static camera. When we first got the landslide awarded, we immediately thought that, okay, this is something that we need to previs. We need to figure out how the story beat sort of needs to connect, since it is a difficult effect. It has a beginning, it has a middle and an end, and you kind of always see the landslide through the camera angles. So you needed to be able to read that progression as it kind of happened throughout the sequence. So the first thing that we thought was to actually create like a low resolution first pass of a simulated landslide and then use that with various time offsets to try to get some sort of to hit the story beats of how the landslide could feel throughout the sequence. Our CG supervisor Timmy Lundin created a very low resolution animation friendly version of the landslide, just using some constraints and breaking up sort of the mountain geometry into small pieces. And then we used some masks that we could paint on this surface to drive like when the landslide is starting to activate. And also if it should have maybe secondary activation. So maybe it activates first once and then another section kind of drops down. And then it could just fall down like this. And we had some trees and stuff that we instanced on top of it. And it was super lightweight and we could use that setup to create a more elaborate version of the post-vis, and then we could use that to kind of get the whole sequence maybe not approved, but at least Michael and Justin, they could have like opinions on, yes, this is it, you've hit the story beats now, let's move on to creating the landslide. We took an agent, a person that went into the crowd system, and we tried to figure out how many things can we get away with not skinning here. So all of the props that they had, like if they were carrying crates that were made of wood, they were not gonna deform, they were not gonna bend, they could be rigid, we don't need to skin those, they're just gonna be there. And then we thought, okay, but can we push this further? And then we thought the helmets, they're metallic, sure, they will have some cloth pieces here and there, but on a crowd system of this scale you would never really see it, especially if you're using that setup for background and midground characters. And then we went even further, so maybe shoulder plates, maybe the plates they have on their thighs, they could also be static maybe or not skinned. And then we took it even further, so the heads, maybe they don't need to be deforming. You wouldn't really see on background and midground characters if they had any deformations. But then we started to get a little bit greedy and we thought, how far can we push it? So we actually, we pushed the system so that we broke everything up by the joints And that sort of created large sausage pieces, is what we call them, because they look like sausages. So everything, forearms, upper arms, hands, upper legs, lower legs, they were just like non-skinned pieces. And then we put that into the crowd system, and that really minimized the amount of skinning we had, and that reduced both the export time, the render times, and the size on disk by a huge amount. We took that system, we did a stress test where we tried to render 300,000 samurai, so three times more than what was asked for us. And I think it ended up being like 15 frames or 15 megabytes per frame. And it was like, okay. And then of course to render it, it was a little bit heavy. It was like 70, 80 gigs, but it was still, you got a 600 time increase in amount of people that we could have in a crowd system for less than half of like the disk cost. So that was great. But of course, yes, we were supposed to do 100,000, but when we did that, it was so much visual noise that it just looked like render noise. So we had to kind of take that back a little bit. So we did another optimization round, and instead of rendering 300,000, we rendered 10,000. And like all of a sudden, you could see that this looks still like a large scale army, but you can see that there are people there now. And I think we had like 190 unique like pieces in the 300,000 test. In the 10,000 test, I think we went down to maybe 100 in total. And that brought everything down even further to like 10 megabytes per frame. And to render these 10,000 people, it took 2.5 gigs of memory to render it. Just nothing. So that's great. Like then we knew we could do this at scale. And there we go.
My name is Niklas Jacobson, and I'm one of the co-founders and also a visual effects supervisor at Important Looking Pirates. We founded the company 2008 with the vision to become, an international established visual effects facility. At the time, there was no feature film, there was no television series work in Stockholm, but we had worked abroad and was very inspired by the blooming industry in London at the time. But after a few years, we felt we wanted to be close to family and friends. We wanted to be back in Sweden, but we still wanted to do these kinds of the projects, the amazing stuff. And we wanted to invest in the technology and pipeline. And we've seen the industry in London and the US at the time, and it was very developed. That was our idea. We want to start a company, and we want to one day be able to compete with the big international studios. And we set out and we founded Important Looking Pirates. So the first 5 years was all about, building infrastructure, establishing the culture, and, setting the tone for the company. So they were very formative years. And then I would say the next period of time was our breakthrough. One of our most important shows was Kon-Tiki, which is a Nordic co-production, where we did water simulations, but also a shark. That was our first feature film. And that was the project that put us on the map internationally. And that led to our first television series, which was Crossbones, a pirate show with pirate ships and 100 shots and something we have never done before, the quantity of work. So we entered the American market and we started doing larger quantities and higher profile work. And we kept true to our philosophy with the quality and just making the best pictures we could. And that spread. Clients appreciated that. We started to build a reputation. So I would say the next 5 years was all expanding into a mid-sized company, maturing into a mid-sized company, where we started to really building out our support infrastructure, more research and development, more tech, more HR, and all of these things that you need to do to establish into a more mature company. And we're super grateful. And today we're working on some of the most exciting projects, the very exciting television shows, and AAA movies, and we're very, very, very proud of the work that we're doing.